I've spent the most years, the most time in the last 4 years, I realized, is in Canada. I feel Canadian, you know?
Are you like a Canadian? Can we call, are you, you're almost like an honorary citizen at this point, I
just
think.
About. Well, New Zealanders are the same. We apologize for everything, too. So I've been in pretty well. I was like, so what's the worst of everything? And,
so what are like your go-to Canadian things that you're spending so much time in Canada? Are you, what have you kind of become fond of? Like, what is your plan when this thing inevitably happens?
What worries me is I just know I will be the first one eaten or turned into a zombie. I'm garbage. I'd have a bike helmet on, I'd be cowering in fear. I would love to think I'd be this action hero who would save the day. I wouldn't. I'd be the first one eaten, and hopefully at least I could sacrifice myself and some of my loved ones could get away.
It's true. Surround yourself with people slower than you, I think, is a good one.
I'll be that slow person in the back for everyone, for all of you guys.
And you're also, you know, being in Vancouver, you're close to, like, islands. I think, I fear zombies can't swim, so you'd be safe if you maybe swam out to
them. Never seen a zombie swim. That would be interesting, actually. We haven't done any swimming in the show yet. Maybe she eats, like, Ian Thorpe's brain or something. No?
Yeah, I was going to ask, because your character, of course, you know, eating a lot of brains in this, and then absorbing some of their memories and personality traits. If there was a brain you could eat, you would want to jump into their life for a little bit. Whose brain would you want to eat?
See, I'm really stuck on true crime. I would love to know, like, the true answers to some of these big serial kind of mysteries or, you know, the staircase, those kinds of stories. I feel like I would like to use it to be kind of like Liv does, crime solve, you know?
That would make you murder, like, Stephen Avery's brain.
Exactly, Stephen Avery's brain. Hopefully, I don't want to kill him. When he passes in time, his brain,
yeah. This is all theoretical. All right.
Yeah.
But being on a show like this, I feel like it's got to be a lot of fun because you're playing, like, it's like multiple shows stuck together in a way because you're, you know, you have all these different, like, it's a zombie show, but then there's also, like, the detective side of it and all this. Like, how fun is it to be a part of this? Because you feel like it'd be, like, the time of your life doing this.
Yeah, it's so cool. When you do a TV show, you never know. You could be signed up for 7 years, God willing, to play the same character on and on and on, and unless you get some sort of variety in that, it can end up being kind of boring. So for me, Liv is like the ideal TV character to play where I will never get bored, I never know what's coming next. I'm terrified. They've like used up all my special skills now, so I keep saying like Liv's gonna be like eating a dishwasher's brain or something now, like I'm running out, so we'll see. But it's kind of a dream role to play, and I love the cast that I work with. We have so much fun, so I feel kind of lucky.
What was your reaction to the script? Because I feel like this idea on paper just would sound very bizarre, you know what I mean?
Totally. I mean, the only reason that I had faith in it was, well, for starters, Mike Orr and Chris Robertson have written such a great comic series, and I thought that the concept that we were drawing from was really strong. And also Rob Thomas and Diane Ruggiero Wright, who made the show, as we had the evidence of Veronica Mars to look at and party down, and I knew that they could deliver on these sort of strange concepts, so I trusted them and kind of went blindly into it, and it's been a lot of fun ever since.
Yeah, who would have thought that guy from Matchbox 20 would be a show like this, eh? Just different Rob Thomas, okay?
So I did eat his brain.
Fun fact. Now we do have a lot of audience questions, I know, so we do have two mics and one in each aisle, so you guys can, let's get you lined up and let's get through as many as we can.
Thanks so much for coming down, by the way, guys. I really, really appreciate it. It's really nice to meet all of you, and I'm so grateful. Thank you.
So yeah, there's one.
It's gelatin. Okay, so there's a difference. It's a long answer, really, because when it's the raw brain that you see like on the posters to things, or if Liv's eating straight from someone's skull, God, I never thought I'd say that sentence, but it's gelatin, and that's kind of covered in corn syrup, and that's disgusting. It's like sweet, sour, weird, all over the map. But when they cook the recipes, like when Liv does the food montages, they've got so sophisticated now. And if it's a cooked meal, for example, if it's a brain burger, it might be ground turkey or beef. So when they're prepared in different ways, they're not always awful. But I don't recommend the gelatin corn syrup brain recipe. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, where did you like most being on university? Tina, flip sex, and which one was your favorite that you liked?
Oh, that's so tricky. They're pretty different projects. I feel like I can't really compare Masters of Sex and Hercules. Maybe you can, actually. Maybe that's a very good comparison. No, I mean, playing, the one that really stands out to me from that is Xena, because I was 9 and I got to take on somebody's character. So i.e., for those of you who don't know, I don't need her brain. But her soul was put into my body, so that was the first time. It was actually when Lizzie Lawless was pregnant, and they basically needed to shoot the lighter episode for her. So they put her soul in this little 9-year-old's body, and that was really fun. It was the first real characterization that I got to play. And it films just down the street from where I grew up in New Zealand, and Lucy was an amazing mentor. I still have like tape recordings of her doing like a war cry for me. So she was really generous with her time. And it was the first time that I really felt like I was acting, I would say, and was enjoying the craft. So that stands out. Thank you.
I like how your roles are all like you absorbing somebody's like personality.
And I was like, I'm never good enough, just as me, right?
Like totally typecasting. Maybe someone to play this person who can like absorb their life. Oh, Rose.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, don't make her play herself. She's garbage, but yeah, take somebody else. She's fine.
All right, back over to this side.
So Gavin's Liv is like out of the zombie closet, as it were. Do you think ever?
Yes, I know we are going to see her mum and her brother again. It's something that I've wanted for a long time for the show to explore that family. And I think part of the problem has been that we have series regulars, and I have to serve various storylines for each of those characters. So when we have Ravi and Peyton and Blaine and Major and Clive, and we want to look at all of their worlds as well, Liv's family didn't really cross over into that world quite as much, but it's something we're looking to do, and I know they had some plans to bring them back, and I would love to know about Liv's dad, so I'm curious about that too.
Thank you.
Cheers.
I love I Love, but I want to ask you about time. There's a lot of things we can do in that show. Just want you to talk about how different it is when you're playing against the whole floating in the air as opposed to
you would think that it would be more challenging to play against a ball floating in the air, but the truth is when you're working with Robert Buckley and Raoul Coley on iZombie and they're teasing you behind the camera and winding you up and trying to make you laugh, I actually find myself longing for that floating ball from Tinker Bell days, where at least it wasn't going to give me anything that threw me off. It can be tricky, it can be a little bit... You know, I really like, I think you draw a lot of your performance from another person, and I find that the best way to work, ideally. But for them to create the world that they do, and for them to be able to do all the flying sequences, things like that, it's intensity, and I think they do it really well. They have such sophisticated, like, stunt rigs and studios, and that they make it as comfortable as it possibly can be. But it's a shame, because I like working with that cast, so I'd always rather the cast were in there.
Thank you. I wanted to ask if you could in any way into her personality and if you would choose any other character in this ensemble.
I do relate a little bit to, I'd say I'm fairly moody. I'd say my family would say I'm fairly moody. I get really overjoyed about things. I need to burn out quite easily, and I think it lends itself to being an actor quite well, because you have to give quite a lot of energy and then you need to shut down and sort of have your own time a little bit. So weirdly, I actually saw that in Tinkerbell. I saw that she's a really generous spirit and she tries to connect with the Evil Queen and the people around her, and then she runs out and she gets grumpy and she feels like she's given a lot and it hasn't been noticed. So that sort of up and downness of her, I think, is a really human characteristic that we don't see all the time in TV shows. People kind of seem to always have the same character and be the same person, and I like that Tink is kind of contradictory and unpredictable, and I feel like I could be a bit like that too, so I related to that. And if there's another character, when I was little, I feel like Cinderella was a good one. That would have been a really fun character to play. But I love Tinkerbell. I never saw myself playing her. Growing up, I always thought if I was able to play a character in Peter Pan, it would be more of a Wendy. And so I was thrilled when I got Tinkerbell. I was like, I thought they kind of reinvented her a little bit and took a chance on me. Thank you.
Back over the side.
Hi, I was wondering what your favorite crime was to solve on iZombie.
My favorite crime to solve. I had a lot of fun solving Dominatrix crime. it's hard, it's like trying to choose. There's so many different things. Like, I love Dungeons and Dragons brain because I got to work with all of the cast together. We had so much fun. To be honest, they keep popping into my head all of the different ones. Magician Brain was really fun because I got to learn all of the tricks, and I thought that was a funny crime. Like, what a way to go. The card to the throat. It's kind of the variety is what makes it special for me. I don't have one particular favorite crime, but there have been lots of good things about all of them. Thank you.
Hi. So I have a weird question. When you guys go to the different zombies' houses, they would have these mixtures of hot sauces. What is your favorite hot sauce?
I love habanero. I'm a huge habanero fan, and I like to put habanero and tahini on everything at all. That's like my dream combo. And I had always done that before playing Liv, so that was kind of nice that when I started playing her, I was able to explore. They've given us, actually Warner Brothers released this kind of range of hot sauces, so I've tried all sorts of different ones now. I don't know if anybody, did anyone see the video of me eating the ghost pepper? Anybody? Yeah, Raul Coley took me to a wing place and made me try the ghost pepper wing, and I have this video footage which is like, 2 full-on minutes of tears streaming down my cheeks and just like rubbing napkins all over my mouth trying to get it out. It was pretty brutal. I'm not a ghost pepper person, I would say that. That was learned the hard way. But in general, I can handle hot sauce, yeah.
Yeah, so does that make the gelatin taste a little bit better?
Exactly, I just put it on the gelatin and try to hide the flavor. It's actually a lot of my cooking too. If I make a meal and it's not very good, there's a lot of hot sauce on it. Just hide whatever's wrong with it underneath. Thank you.
I've played a character for so long now, going into season 4. At this point, as you're getting into her mind, are you finding that you have an influence on kind of maybe her story arc of it, where it's going? Are you able to contribute more on that front?
I trust the writers. They're so strong, and it's kind of like, I've had some ideas, and I always reach out to them when I do, but in general, the things that they bring to me are much more brilliant, much more original than anything that I would be coming up with anyway, so I'm quite happy to know my place in that situation. There are a few. I did think a bodybuilder brain would be pretty fun, doing a gym bunny, just always sort of on steroid cycles and sort of photographing themselves in mirrors and posing, but we'll see. Maybe one day.
All right, back on the side.
Really good as Tinkerbell, but I was wondering if you could choose any other character on Once Upon a Time, which would you have chosen?
I mentioned that Cinderella would be something that would appeal to me. I feel like it'd be quite cool to do a gender cross and do Hook or something. I'd be really interested in that, actually. I think it's such a fascinating character. Colin O'Donoghue does a wonderful job. But sassy, and it's pretty, there's a confidence and a fear that are playing together in that character that I find really interesting, and I'd love to explore that at some point. Who knows, maybe some stage production when I'm 75, I'll do I'll play Hook or something. you guys will be first in line, I'm sure.
All right, back over to you.
Why did you decide to take the part for Once Upon a Time?
I think Once Upon a Time had established itself as a really strong show. I thought it was such a great idea, reinventing story tales and exploring like how those characters could actually exist in a real world as well. So I think the story really spoke to me. Playing Tinkerbell, obviously playing like an icon that I, as a child, had so enjoyed reading about and watching. So it was sort of inevitable. As soon as I found out that they offered me the role, I thought I would love to do that.
Like
a prank stuff?
No, I mean, like, you're just thinking of the memento from Seth. You know,
oh, yeah, I've stolen from Seth many times. I feel like I probably shouldn't be putting this on camera, but I think they know. There'll be sort of bugs that disappear or like books off those bookshelves that suddenly go missing. And I'm good though, I wait till we've like finished shooting that scene so it doesn't mess with the continuity.
Like, I was going to say, the continuity here is it's all just you stealing things.
Yeah, exactly. But I've definitely dipped into some of her stuff, for sure.
Sure,
and also the prop food, like when they bring prop food in, we just did this romantic comedy brain. And there's a whole lot of like cupcakes and cakes and things, and you better believe it's like a feeding frenzy at the end of that. They like go to pick things back up off the table, and not just me, the rest of the cast, the rest of the crew are all in there, and there's like cookies hanging out of people's mouths, so they're dealing with more thieves than just me, at least.
All right, back on into the set.
Hi, Rose. You've been in a lot of brains, Liv, a lot of personalities. I'm just wondering which brain you really get to.
I related to the most?
Yeah, like your personality.
I relate to Liv a lot, and I think part of what interests me about the role is that everybody says it's like taking on a different character each week, but to me it's not. It's finding something else that you already have inside you each week, and it's an exaggerated version for sure, because she's a zombie and she's eating their brains, but I think we all are made up of all of these different threads, and different experiences wake those up in you. You might think you're a shy person for most of your life, and then some environment brings out this really confident, self-assured version. It's like, I prefer to think of it as Liv has a lot of different interests and a lot of different elements to her personality, and they're just awoken at different times. So it's kind of a vague answer to your question, but I relate to Liv in that she feels like she's more than one thing, and she can't really be put in a box. Thank you.
Back over here. I've got another brain question. If you could eat somebody from history, who would you choose?
I love dancing. Like, I love ballet. I love, like, tap dancing. I'm not that good at any of these things, but I respect it so much, and I watch a lot of it. So I feel like I just recently watched Funny Face, the Audrey Hepburn. The original Funny Face, and her dancing in that blows my mind. I feel like it seems disrespectful to eat someone's brain, but I would eat Audrey Hepburn's brain and just kind of explore how she could. I mean, I don't even know she's a ballerina, and she kind of had this successful acting career and just happened to also have this incredible physical ability. So I'll take her this. Or Peter Bausch, but that's too recent. That seems off. Thank you.
Hi, so it sounds like you have a lot of fun on set, and I was wondering if you have any funny stories from behind the scenes.
One of my favorite things that happened, I wish that we could release this footage, but I don't think it would be illegal to, was the Grumpy Old Man brain. This was the saving grace of that whole episode for me, was that we had a lovely actress, was riding a mobility scooter and was coming towards me, Ravi, and Bamino in this one scene. And she hadn't kind of worked out how to use the mobility scooter totally properly. I'm sure it was our fault, not hers, but she didn't quite have grip on how to use the brakes versus the accelerator. And she was like rattling towards us. And there were sandbags that were supposed to stop her on the ground, like physical marks. And when she was supposed to press the brake, she used the accelerator and like hopped over the sandbags and was literally coming straight at me. And we've watched this footage in slow-mo so many times, but like, you see, I stop and I realize that if I don't stop, she's gonna go out into the middle of the road. And so this is like the most heroic thing I feel like I've ever done. I'm gonna give myself this. I like go to stop her with my hands to be like, whoa, she's gonna, you know. And Raul, who plays Ravi, literally dives out of the way and cowers behind Babino. Malcolm, who was just like thinking on his feet, he's grabbed her all and he didn't really have a chance to do anything. But it was just this amazing piece of footage that you watch in slow-mo and you see me be like, please stop, you're okay. And you see Raoul just dive into safety. So that was a pretty funny on-set moment. We all enjoyed that. Everybody except Raoul enjoyed that.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Alright. So my girlfriend's a big fan of You're an iZombie, but my question is, Can you explain your experience as being on Power Rangers?
Yes.
Power Rangers was so much fun. I can't tell you. It was like a whole bunch of my friends, because I use a lot of New Zealand actors, and we filmed 15 minutes from my house and growing up, and we literally would just put on like spandex and jump around all day. Like, what is not to love about that job? We got to learn like stunt training. Granted, I had a small Japanese man who did the majority of my stunts with breast pads and a butt. But on the occasions that they let me do it, I was like on harnesses, and it was just kind of this like very fun, like entertaining show to be a part of. And it's got such a great following. It's like, it was cool to be part of that iconic sort of franchise. It was a really, really good experience. So that was what that was like. It was really a bit of a laugh every day. We had a great time.
You're like crossing them all off, right? Like Tinkerbell and the Power Rangers. Anything out there that you want to play? Like anything from your like childhood that you're like, if they brought it back, I would like to do that character, or anything that you're still on the bucket list?
I'm really so wary of remakes because I love originals so much most of the time, and I think there have been really successful remakes of things, but I'd be pretty nervous to do something, especially when I've watched somebody else who I really respect do it beforehand. So I kind of hope that they just, there's a lot of good ideas in the world. I hope that there are some more interesting things that I haven't even thought of yet. Well, I ship Lynn and Jenna, so I hope that Lynn and AJ end up together. I think that ultimately, right now, is not the time for this. There's a pretty big cash guy. There's a zombie apocalypse, I think. So I think I'd like Lynn to concentrate on that. It's like you want to concentrate on this schoolwork and on their children. That's how I feel. So, except it's a zombie apocalypse. So I think that eventually I'd like that. I would like Liv to... It's tricky because, yeah, there's part of me that wants her to be cured because I think life is easier. She doesn't have to eat brains. She's able to have a family. There's lots of great reasons. But she also has found her identity in this whole thing. And she has become this, like, to me, what I love so much about her character is it's this person who dares to be different and acknowledges that they're different and loves and celebrates that. And it's what I love about a lot of the kind of fantasy TV shows and a lot of the reasons, you know, people, the characters that people come and dress up as here, they're iconic and different and they don't look like everybody else, and that's their strength. And it's why I listen to a lot of David Bowie when I'm playing Liv, because that's his whole thing, is about like, yes, being a freak or being something that's different is good, and like find a way to make that the best thing about you, because it's not going to change, you know? So it's hard. I sort of love that Liv is a zombie, you know? She sounded kind of boring before she got turned, honestly. She's like very on track, ticked every box, sort of had 5-year plans, and just didn't really respond spontaneously to her environment, and now she's learned to do that. So I think she's got a much more meaningful existence as a zombie. If there's a way that she could end up being cured and still being able to be that person she's become and take all that good stuff with her, then sure, I'd love that to happen one day. Thank you.
There's no more reason to fear the zombie apocalypse. It might just make us all better, you know?
Well, you think so. There's politics, unfortunately. There's stuff about brain numbers and who has to sacrifice their brains to be eaten, and human, you know, eventually it could end up that humans get treated really terribly by the zombies. You never know kind of... I mean, I love that it's so reflective of some of the stuff we deal with in the world today, where people are marginalized and... you know, the other is considered so scary, and so I don't think that it should have to be all zombies or all humans. It feels like it would be great for people to be able to accept differences, learn to live with each other, and find a healthy balance, you know?
Well, I think if it happens, you should be like the president.
Thank you! Live for president! Live for president of New Seattle.
Alright, back on the side.
Okay, so, huge fan of iZombie, but I got my arm twisted by another crew member to ask a question for them. If you could have any member from the Power Rangers come over to iZombie, who would it be and why?
It would probably be Olivia Tennant, who was in, she played Dr. K in RPM Power Rangers with me. And it's because, as I spoke about before, I'm so good at dance, and she's an amazing tap dancer. And I would love to see, like, this musical episode that we've all been wanting for so long, her to come over and do something in there. That would be really fun.
Thank you. All right, back on this side.
Hi, so I know that you were on Johnny Capahala a long time ago, but I wanted to know, did you actually know how to surf for that movie?
No, I grew up at the beach in New Zealand. The beach that we shot along there is like right by my house. So I had spent a lot of time in the water, and I mean, like, I'd gone out on a surfboard before, but I'm not a surfer. I wish I was. I enjoy it very casually when I can, but certainly not. We haven't seen Liv surf. Maybe that's the last thing that I could possibly do. That'll be my next one. I was like, come on, guys. Or snowboard. Yeah, maybe one of those two. Guys are giving me ideas.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Even RA years RPM and iZombie. So I'm just wondering if Liv suddenly finds Summer's Morpher, what would you think she would do with it?
I would like to think that Liv is a good enough person that she wouldn't manipulate her with that. There's not any bribery or blackmail going on. Hopefully, she's pretty altruistic. She cares about her community. Hopefully, she'd return it to her, you know? She'd probably have a play around on it first, let's be honest, but she'd get it back to someone, I think. Thank you.
Hi, I was just wondering how much of a challenge it is to not have an accent.
Weirdly, it doesn't bother me. I don't know. American accents and British accents, we've heard so much growing up in New Zealand, and I feel really fortunate that hasn't been like a huge hiccup for me. Because I have a lot of friends from down under who are very talented actors but can't do accents at all, and it really limits your ability to work overseas because people are so used to hearing American accents on film. So I'm very grateful that that hasn't been a problem for me. Who knows, if they gave me Irish or something, I'd be just in the same boat as everybody else. I'd be struggling, but American isn't hard, yeah.
The question is, how good is your Canadian accent?
The answer is you're going to find out this season.
There's a lot of stories that I need to get. For some reason, it's sorry, not sorry.
I didn't tell you I'm being a hockey good friend, so.
Uh-oh. There's a scoop for you.
There's a scoop. Yeah, don't tell anyone.
Exclusive. All right, we have time for a couple more questions, so let's go back over here.
Hi. I asked Rahul this on a stream we did a couple months ago. Did you ever read any of the iZombie comics before or after doing the show?
Yeah, I read all of them. I read them once I found out that I had the pilot, and we didn't even know if we had a series or not. You kind of just filmed that first episode and hope. And so as soon as I found out I had the character, if something's been based off source material, I kind of feel like out of respect, you wanted to read and understand where that's from. It just so happened that once I started, I really enjoyed them, and Michael Red and Chris Robinson did such a great job and was so supportive, because that is not always the case when you're adapting material. So it's been really lucky that I have been able to go to them and ask them questions, or you know, hear feedback from them. Saw Mike actually last week, a couple of weeks ago, in Portland. And they've been so, so wonderful. So those comics are fantastic, and they've been a great resource for me. Thank you.
Hi, Rose. I'm a huge fan of iZombie, and would like you to know that your acting is really great. I think you're one of the best actors right now. I would like to talk about your leading men. You have a bunch of attractive leading men. You're like the Khaleesi.
It's a tough job, right?
Yeah, you're like the Khaleesi of the soap world. So, I'd like to know which one is your favorite leading man, and which is your
least favorite? Well, who's my favorite
scene? Favorite leading man.
I mean, if I answer that question, I'm about to make a few other enemies, so I can't really answer my favorite. I'd say that I have different dynamics with each of the guys. They have become like brothers to me. They are so wonderful and supportive and patient. And that we all have a similar sense of humor. So we have a great time together. We're from literally all over the world. We could not be from more different backgrounds and different kind of lives. And it's been so great to get to know each other and learn tons about what it's like growing up in New York or London or Claremont, which is where Robert Buck is from. I can't choose a favorite. I work with Malcolm the most, and then Rommel. So I know them very, very well. So maybe that's a good thing, or maybe it's a rare treat when I get to see the other guys. It's kind of however you look at it. But my favorite scene, I've answered this really, but the Dungeons and Dragons who were all at one table, because we don't get to work together very often, and that was a time where Bart and David Anders, we were all in a scene together, and we just had so much fun. It was about a 15-hour day on set, and truly we just like didn't want it to end, and that's a pretty special feeling, working long hours to just be having such a good time that you'd rather it kept going. Thank you.
I love the Khaleesi of the Zombie World.
Khaleesi of the Zombie World. That's it looks like if you read an article and that's the sentence that pops out, you know?
Like, Liv, mother of zombies. I think we got it.
Yeah, seriously.
You should add that to the IMDb.
Okay, I'll see what I can do. I know people in places.
All right, let's go back to the side.
On the show, obviously, Liv gets really creative with her cooking, and I was wondering if there's a meal you could make with the grains, what would it be?
I actually asked for the recipe for this one like hot chili soup thing that they made, wrote it down and lost it, and I'm too scared to go back to Juno and ask for it again because it seems like I didn't care. So that's the great loss actually for me on iZombie is that recipe. I'll have to get it off them again sometime later, but the recipes are all really good. I love cooking, so hopefully there'll be a few others that are really fantastic that stand out and I'll be able to take home. I like cooking, I like making bread. I like anything from scratch, basically. That's a cool experience, it's starting from scratch. So we'll see what we can do.
Thank you.
Do you know what? Some fans have made me a recipe book, and it's amazing. It's like they've written up their versions of what they've seen in the montages, and then also some of their own ideas. It's so clever. So much more creative than I am, honestly. It's brilliant. We do it takes about an hour and a half every morning, and it's a wig cap. It's like braiding my hair, and then a wig cap, and then a wig, and then 2 wig pieces basically to put in this wig, and then I get airbrushed, and I have some pretty significant eye makeup and that is Amber Trudeau, who's our no relation, but Amber Trudeau is our makeup, and she is incredible. She is so talented. She does all of the frozen zombies as well. She makes them look like that. She's so gifted. So she does all of that for me, and that takes about an hour and a half between her and Mariah, who does the hair. And that's the process every morning, and it's really helpful having such a distinct looking character because you really feel like you become her after that's all on. I go into blocking though sometimes. Before we shoot a scene, we block the scene. So I'll come in the first thing and walk through, you know, we come up with where the scene is going to lie on the floor, and we say the words a few times and get it onto its feet. And most of the time when I'm doing that, it's when I've got the wig cap on but no wig or anything. And the crew have all got various to see me. I say I look like a boiled egg. I'm like, it's kind of weird, like the white makeup and then this white wig cap, but it's not a flattering look for me, I'll say that. So it's quite lengthy and they do a good job.
Awesome, thank you. On this side.
iZombie. When you're acting as Liv in the full-out zombie mode, what's it like?
I love doing the Rage Out Zombie. It hurts your voice doing it on the kind of growl sound, but other than that, it's awesome. Sometimes we have to use things like red contact lenses that are like giant ones that fill up your eye, and whenever I see cosplayers wearing those, I'm always suffering because I know how comfortable they are.
Get the episode and I can see in each scene where all the
what they want me to play. For me, it's been really important to try to make sure we still see Liv and the Liv who's in relationships and the Liv who loves her friends and works really hard and is vulnerable and not just the caricature of her. I really want people to still care about this character, so that's my focus actually. It's how to handle that brand, but also keep her pretty as grounded as a zombie comedy procedural drama can possibly be. So I try to do that. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. You're like the sweetest person in the world, I think.
That's the nicest thing I've ever said to me.